70% of Americans can't go an hour without it. The addiction that may have taken over the lives of your friends and family on today's 700 Club Interactive.
Well, welcome to the show. Technology has made it easier for us to connect, communicate, and socialize. But the problem with these things, that all these advances can also be damaging, as it has introduced phrases such as crackberry and iPad envy to the English language.
Yeah, just one. I'll be there in 5. Well, joining us now is author and counselor Dr. Gregory Janz. Greg, thanks for being with us.
Oh, good to be with you. This is an important topic.
It is. You've made a provocative statement in your book, Hook, The Pitfalls of Media, Technology, and Social Networking, where you tell us that smartphones are kind of like LSD. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, well, you know, we're seeing more and more folks who truly are addicted to technology. 75% of the folks we work with cannot put down their device for one day without checking it. And we're finding people with true anxiety disorder. By that, what I mean is they get physical symptoms if they can't get to their device.
I'll tell you a story of one of my friends where I sort of secretly took his smartphone and he started to get all kinds of anxiety because he couldn't find it. And it was kind of odd, and the more he got distressed, you know, it was just a space of about 90 seconds, and he couldn't find it, and I gave it back to him. He didn't talk to me for a while after that. Why do we get addicted to it? Why do we have feelings of anxiety if we can't find our phone or go for a period of time without checking our email?
You know, Gordon, that's a great question. And one of the reasons is we actually find ourselves addicted in a sense that because we live in a one-click society, so everything is instant, And the technology teaches us to have what I call low impulse control. We actually have trouble controlling our impulses. That said, one of the things that we want to be able to do is we want to balance technology in our lives. But my concern is even what we're modeling for our kids.
There's a new study coming out of Stanford about how young men today, because they're spending so many hours doing video games and, frankly, so many hours watching internet porn, that their ability to interact with females is at risk now. Are you familiar with that?
I am familiar with that. And one of the things that we see is for people that develop primarily virtual relationships, really not true online or true real relationships, they don't go through the normal relationship stages. And so, you know, online, of course, on Facebook, or I mean, I look perfect online. Remember, we always present our very best. So that said, we find ourselves more and more moving towards these virtual relationships, which many times take us where we don't really want to go. The average age of exposure to pornography on the internet is actually 11 years old.
That is that's a shock. I didn't know that stat.
Yes.
I've heard it's as high as 50% of males, 25% of females have a problem with online pornography. And the numbers are just getting kind of...
That is growing, yes.
I mean, it's really starting to get staggering, and there's an addiction there, too, that's even separate from the whole technology addiction.
Absolutely.
I've noticed a phenomenon where texting seems to be taking over for conversation, where literally you'll have people in the same room texting each other as opposed to talking. Fundamentally changing our social interactions as a culture?
Oh, my goodness. I must tell you from personal experience, I have two boys. I knew I had a problem when at the dinner table they're texting back and forth to each other. Yes. And, you know, our young people don't use a cell phone to make phone calls. They use a cell phone for texting. I called my son the other day, and he didn't answer. But then he texts me back and said, "Dad, what do you want?" And the texting has its own unique language as well. And, you know, if you don't know the language of texting, there's a generation gap there.
Your book also points out that there's another factor here, that the technology is actually increasing stress, increasing anxiety for us. How does that happen?
Well, the stress and anxiety, one of the things that happens, Gordon, is we find ourselves, here's my smartphone right here. We find ourselves, if we can't get to this thing, and it creates these physical symptoms of anxiety. How this develops is we keep this with us. I have clients who come to see us. They actually sleep with their smartphone, with their device, because they don't want to miss the text. You know, that's a problem.
Yeah, I would say. That's a problem. What can we do to get back to, old-fashioned connections, old-fashioned conversation, real interpersonal connecting with another person? How can we get there?
One of the things I want to make sure that we're doing is that we are actually spending more time with our real relationships in person versus our virtual relationships. And one of the things you might want to try is take one day, maybe it's going to be Sunday, and do a technology detox. Take that day and just set it aside and don't involve yourself with technology for one day. See how you feel. See if there's physical symptoms. See how you feel emotionally. Do you feel disconnected? But allow that just as a place of starting. One of the things I want you to do is when you're with people, really be with them. Don't be, have you ever been with somebody and they're texting away here at their device and they look up and they go, "What'd you say?" Be fully present in reality with relationships.
No more multitasking. All right, good tips. Thank you. If you'd like to find out more about Greg's work, you can go to 700clubinteractive.com, and his book, Hooked, is available wherever books are sold. And thanks for being with us today.
Good to be here today. Thank you, Gordon.
Well, you've heard how addictive text messaging can be, or Just one text message in this next story helped save a young woman's life. Find out how right after this.
This is the American Bible Challenge.
From the creators of Extreme Makeover Home Edition comes a game show 3,400 years in the making.
Here is the Facebook page of Isaac's father. What's his name? Absolutely right.
On August 23rd.
Ready to win some money for your charities?
Winning has never felt so good.
These people are playing to bless somebody else.
The American Bible Challenge premieres Thursday, August 23rd on GSN.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
Tomorrow.
This is my daughter, Cora.
Meet the Manns, stars of Tyler Perry's Meet the Browns.
Welcome to our humble commode.
On the next 700 Club Interactive.
Well, today we've been discussing the dangers of technology. However, in Indonesia, it was a text message that saved one girl's life. Watch this.
Hannah was only 15 when she left her village and moved to the city to find work. Her parents were simply too poor to continue providing for her.
I felt like a stranger in Jakarta. I didn't know anyone. Everything was so different.
Hannah found work as a live-in housekeeper. One night after work, she found CBN's Solusi program, the Indonesian version of the 700 Club. Hannah began watching it every night.
I was interested in the stories. I could identify with the people in them.
After watching one evening, Hannah fell asleep and began to dream.
I dreamt that I was in a place I'd never seen before. Then suddenly, a big cross was in front of me. I felt very peaceful.
The next morning, Hannah wondered what the dream meant, so she sent a text message to CBN. A prayer counselor contacted Hannah and began to tell her about God. Soon, the teenager prayed to receive Jesus as her Savior.
When I prayed with CBN, I felt happy in my heart. I started believing that Jesus truly exists. I thought, this could be the start of a new life for me.
Within a few days, someone from CBN met with Hannah, helped her to find a church, and bought her a new Bible.
CBN is so amazing. Through their ministry, a lot of people are finding Jesus as Savior. I'm so thankful for them.
That's what we're about here at CBN. We want to preach the gospel, the good news, around the world, and we want to do it in their own language. So we view our role as training and equipping Christians in their own culture how to do Christian television. And then showing stories of what Jesus is doing, not here in America, but right there in their own country, with people that look like them, talk like them. We want to make it culturally relevant so they can hear and understand the good news. If you want to be a part of it, if you want to be a part of preaching the gospel around the world through television, all you have to do is join the 700 Club. And you can be a part of it because a portion of every gift goes into the work of CBN International to do just that. We have 15 production centers scattered around the world. We're training local Christians how to do Christian television, and all it takes is for you to say, yeah, I want to join. I want to be a part of that. Call us. The number's toll-free, 888-777-1999. Just say, I want to be a member of the 700 Club. It's $20 a month, 65 cents a day. When you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. You don't have to write a check. There's nothing to mail in. The bank does all the work for you every month. We save so much on the processing. We can send as our gift to you Power for Life monthly teaching CDs. So if you'd like that, ask for Pledge Express when you call. Well, coming up, a killer habit.
That would be on 5 narcotics and a fifth of whiskey in a day. You couldn't feel any lower than I felt. Just absolutely devastated, heartbroken, and ashamed of myself.
This woman's wake-up call, next on 700 Club Interactive.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer, that I decided, if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else and to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things. Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people and they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Every minute counts when you're fighting cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
The American Bible Challenge.
From the creators of Extreme Makeover Home Edition comes a game show 3,400 years in the making.
Here is the Facebook page of Isaac's father. What's his name? Absolutely right.
On August 23rd.
Ready to win some money for your charities?
Winning has never felt so good.
These people are playing to bless somebody else.
The American Bible Challenge premieres Thursday, August 23rd on GSN.
When we're children, we often don't control the things that happen around us, and we sometimes get into some very bad reactions. For Amanda, what happened to her was her parents' divorce, and it led her straight down a road to a life of addiction. Watch this.
She is your problem.
I don't remember any good times of my parents being married.
No, just like you.
Not one single time.
Spending money like it's water.
I was just sad.
Amanda Herring's parents divorced when she was five. She went to live with her father, who remarried. Amanda didn't feel like she fit in with the new family and felt neglected.
I felt very insignificant, really insecure. It was awful. I felt very forgotten.
When she got older, she met a young man who showered her with attention. He was also rich and bought Amanda lots of gifts. She didn't know where he got his money until she overheard him yelling on the phone.
And I was like, who are you talking to? And he was cussing, mad. And that's when I found out. He said, I sell dope. My mom's a crackhead. And she broke into my room and stole all my dope. And I was just like, wow.
Her boyfriend was a notorious drug dealer.
I knew that it was wrong, not only morally wrong, but criminally wrong. So I guess it was maybe exciting. Wow, this is like a whole world I never knew about. Like, there's a lot of money involved, you know, a lot of flashy stuff, jewelry, cars.
Amanda found herself deep in the drug world and wrapped up in her boyfriend's obsession with her. She thought it was charming until the boyfriend threatened to kill a mutual friend. He thought the friend had tried to rape Amanda. She tried to convince him it wasn't true.
He did not do it.
But he didn't believe her.
He was planning to kill this guy. He was not hiding his feelings about this. So he calls him to the park. And when he got to the park, next thing you know, he started shooting him. Shot him 5 times. After the 5th shot, he was dead.
Amanda's boyfriend was sentenced to 24 years in prison. When her father found out, he disowned her and blamed her drug-related lifestyle on the murder of an innocent man.
As true as can be.
He told me that I was better off dead, that he never wanted to see me again. It was the worst thing that I had ever, worst thing in my life.
Amanda relied on drugs and alcohol to numb all emotions.
I went from smoking weed to snorting cocaine to popping ecstasy pills. I would do them all in one day. Oh, it was bad. I would be on 5 narcotics and a fifth of whiskey in a day.
Then Amanda got pregnant. She managed to stop the drugs and drinking until the baby was born, but then gave the baby to her mother. Amanda knew it was the best thing for her daughter.
It was very depressing to be off away from her and kind of and just wondering, what's my baby thinking? What's going through her mind? Does she miss me? You know, does she think I'm never going to come around? Does she think one day it'll be a normal family? Does she think we're not normal? Is she glad I'm not around?
Amanda's worry didn't stop her daily self-destruction.
I would buy every drug, and I would just do them. Drinking whiskey, I could not function without it. Did not know how I would survive a day without it. Had to have it. Physically, mentally, emotionally, had to have it. I knew that I could not gain anything from this kind of lifestyle. I knew that the way I was living was totally wrong. It was just so hard being away from my daughter, but knowing that I was not any kind of good example that needed to be around her. She didn't need to be around me. In my mind, I was just trash.
When her child got older, Amanda decided she wanted a second chance and asked to move in with her mom and daughter. She tried to quit drinking, but one day passed out drunk. Her daughter found her and thought she was dead. Terrified, the little girl ran through the neighborhood for help.
You couldn't feel any lower than I felt, just absolutely devastated, heartbroken, and ashamed of myself. So sad that I had put her in a position to be scared that her mom was going to die and she was going to have to deal with a dead mom. I mean, that is like, it was horrifying. I could not believe that my 9-year-old had to deal with that because of me. It scared me to death, and I begged God not to let that happen. I begged God to save my life. And I was so repentant, and I was just ready to let him. I just surrendered, just ready to let him work me out. I knew he could. Everything that I had ever known about God and his goodness and his grace and his mercy immediately came to me right then. That day, I knew without a doubt that God was going to save my life. I knew that he was going to help me and that I was going to be fine. Everything right then just came to me, and I knew that it was over. That life was over, and a new life was beginning.
Amanda went to a Christian treatment facility. There, she began a new life.
It was just unbelievable saturation with the Word of God. I mean, just genuine, wonderful, wonderful program. Nothing but the Lord.
Amanda soon met Trey and became his wife. They have 3 more children together, and they both work in full-time ministry.
I'm in awe daily, just grateful and in awe, and just humbled, thankful, amazed. Anyone can be saved and be used by God if I can, for sure.
And you can be saved. You know, the Bible says, whosoever, for God so loved the world, that means you, that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe on him would have everlasting life. Now, if you're in an addiction, you're not having everlasting life. You're having everlasting addiction. And every day you wake up and go, oh no, am I going to do this again today? And maybe like Amanda, you can't stop. You don't know how. You literally have to live life, drop by drop. But you can change. There is a Savior. He does want to come to you. He does love you, just as you are right now. He hasn't given up on you. He wants you to just ask him for help. And when you do, he'll come, and he'll provide it, and he'll open the door. Now, some of you, if you've got severe addictions, you need to go into a treatment center. You need to be in a safe, protected environment
where you don't have access to chemicals and alcohol and can be free, can have a period of time where your body adjusts and it's in a supervised environment. But that can all happen for you if you just say yes, if you just surrender and say, God, not my will anymore. Let your will be done in my life. Let your plan come to pass in my life. And if you do that, he'll come. He'll come. He'll be there for you. Here's the prayer for you, and it's a very simple one. Jesus, if you're there, you can even say, I saw what you just did for Amanda. Can you do that for me? Jesus, if you're there, if this is true, if you can help me, will you do that? Will you come to me? Will you show up for me? And will you change my life? And if you pray that with all of your heart, he'll come. He'll be your Savior, your Messiah. He'll change you and change your heart and change your ways. It's that simple. It's not complicated. The Bible says that when you turn to me with all of your heart, when you seek me with all of your heart, then I'll be found. And you can trust those words because those words are true. Believe them. Believe on the one that he sent, and you'll be saved. If you want help, if you need someone to pray with you, we're here for you. And we're here for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And it's a toll-free number. So if you need somebody to agree with you in prayer, just call 888-777-1999. And if you're going through addiction and you're trying to get free, realize that number is there. You can have somebody. We're not here to judge you. We're not here to condemn. We're here to pray. We're here to love you just as Jesus loves you. That's what we want to do. So if you're having struggles and you're being tempted, pick up the phone and call. And say, look, I'm having a compulsion right now. I need somebody to pray through. It's a wonderful thing for you that there's this prayer line where you can call and we'll agree with you in prayer. And just watch what happens. Just try it and see. You can be free. Well, this is 700 Club Interactive, where we want to interact with you. And we've got an inbox question from Sarah. She writes in, 2 years ago, I started taking pain meds for chronic back pain caused by a tumor pressing on the bottom of my spine. I would like to stop taking them now, but I'm addicted. Can you please pray for me for strength to get off? Sarah, I will do that for you, but I also encourage you to go to the doctor who prescribed them and let him know that you're addicted and that you want to come off. Sometimes with narcotic pain medicine, you really do need medical supervision, particularly if it's something that's long-term. Your blood pressure can spike. There's some other things that can happen as you withdraw off some medicine. I don't know the one you're on, but I do counsel for narcotic addiction that you need medical supervision when you come off. Let's pray for you right now. Lord, we just lift Sarah to you, and we break the hold of these pills on her life. And we pray for her back, that she be pain-free. You're not only able to break off addiction, you're able to dissolve tumors so that they no longer have pressure on her spine. So we just speak in faith, believing in the one that God sent, believing in your sacrifice and the stripes that have healed her. And we ask for that now. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's go over to the chat room. I think we've got one quick chat.
We have Julie, and she says, I have a teenage son who spends hours playing video games. He barely interacts with anyone, with the exception of other gamers. What can we do to get him interested in something that is good for him?
Lock up the video game and see. It'll take a little bit of time, but lock it up. If he's spending hours, he's not living. You need to take it away from him for a period of time and see what happens. That's all the time we have for this program. We leave with this word from James. Humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and God will come close to you.